starting off with John Staton. John and I have worked together for a number of years on an area that I'm passionate about, he clearly is very passionate about, which is flowering plants that went back to the sea. These are our seagrasses, but I'm not going to steal your thunder, I'm going to hand over to John, postdoctoral researcher at the University of Western Australia. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Kingsley. So today I'll talk a little bit about seagrass. Maybe half the presentation is going to be about seagrasses, but I know seagrasses for some of you are not the most exciting thing, so I'm going to mix it up a little bit and talk about marine restoration in general. And a lot of the theme we'll be talking about today is applicable to marine restoration across our Western Australian coastline and also Australia. So the title of the presentation today is Marine Restoration in Western Australia, Scaling Up Efforts. So, as you all know, Western Australia is home to a lot of iconic destinations known locally and globally, including the Ningaloo Reef here, Rottnest Island, which I'm sure most have already been to, Shark Bay, which is a World Heritage Listed Area, and also the Amphrolis Islands, which I had some presentation about before. They attract hundreds of thousands to millions of visitors internationally and nationally every year. But there's also a lot of more local destinations such as Busselton and Geograph Bay, Albany, and even Durian Bay, where people go to spend time with their families on holidays and utilise these coastal areas, because we do spend a lot of our time in or near the water, and these are great family destinations. We also have a quite an important link with our estuaries as well. And here I've just got some earlier imagery on the left of the Swan River in Perth and also Princess Royal Harbour, showing our strong link with these locations. And these links have really been forged from the economy. So these areas really opened up to support sort of booming fisheries trade in those areas, and also more local, more recently, in Albany and also in places like Bunbury. We have a lot of port and shipping, and also Fremantle. These areas have also provided quite an important link, thus socially and economically. However, intensive use and also global change have come at a cost. We have seen some losses of these marine habitats, so if any of you have dared to stick your head under water in some of these locations, either near or far, we do have some impact. So these are mooring lines that have been put inside seagrass beds at Rottnest Island, historically placed there. We also have coral bleaching up around Ningaloo, which is not just a function of climate change. There are also a lot of other stresses which add to these bleaching events. Tourists coming along and not really knowing the rules come along and touch and play with corals because they feel really nice and there's different textures, and that sort of damage, that touching, if people have sunscreens and different chemicals on their hands, really cause some damage to these organisms. We have these more large-scale losses, either from large-scale cyclonic events, or even anchor chains moving across the seabed from boats that are anchored, especially large vessels. They sweep along and they can just brush aside large amounts of coral and damage them if they don't actually know the coral there. Smaller boats also do quite a lot of damage to corals, not so much with anchor lines, but ripping up corals as they get pulled up. We also have these more sort of larger scale effects from dredging, so port development and maintenance, dredging in channels. You can create these large sediment plumes which can have very large impacts on the flora and fauna in the marine environment. And here, more locally, we have fish kills in the upper Swan. A lot of this is caused through eutrophication, so a bunch of the nutrients being dumped into these waterways, choking out the systems with rotting algae. We eventually get this low oxygenation of water and eventually fish kills. So, acknowledging all of this, these trends locally are also occurring globally, so they're really following those trends, which is not unsurprising. What is surprising is that within Western Australia, which is known locally and globally as a biodiversity hotspot, not just on land, but also on water. Global hotspot, biodiversity hotspot. There's been very little attention given to trying to restore these areas, even despite the fact that these are areas which contribute to large amounts of tourism because these are biodiversity hotspots, interesting structures on the water that people want to go see, and they also contribute significantly to our fisheries, commercial and recreation. And so despite that, there's been very little attention given to marine restoration of water. Now today, for the remainder of these slides, I'm going to go through five sort of key elements that I think are going to be important to for us to move into the future to try to boost marine restoration. The reason why this is a problem is because a lot of the losses and then the eventual marine restoration that does go on, so it does actually occur, but it generally occurs on much small scales. And usually because someone or a small group of people are quite passionate about something that's happened, and they put a lot of their time and effort in trying to boost this and try to make the environment, or restore the environment back to what it was before. The problem with doing this is that it doesn't actually get to the scale which is ecologically and economically relevant. So we don't actually get to this sort of landscape scale restoration. So this is what I'm going to talk about today. So the first part is we build and communicate a business case for marine restoration. So I'm going to go through an example of the native flat oyster, which was quite abundant down in Albany. It's quite abundant along the southern temperate coast of Australia. One of the ways to build a business case, and through this example I'll demonstrate this, is to document the habitat loss and build awareness in the local community, but also more broadly. So in this instance, they've documented that it has been lost. We've lost about 99% of the native flat oysters from Albany, particular oyster harbour, usually through overfishing, dredging the habitat, and also on the east coast of Australia, there's been disease outbreaks from a parasite called bulimia, which basically reduces the energy levels of the oyster, making it very, basically its inability to close the shell again, and then what happens is just get predated on by other animals. So we have an organism here which has a number of different pressures which are causing its loss. So what does this loss mean? So how do we communicate what this loss means in terms of ecosystem services? So for oysters, they're very good at filtering the water. So they take a lot of the algae, which are full of nutrients, out of the water column. One oyster can filter up to 200 litres of water per day. But if you talk about a large oyster reef, hundreds of square metres into a hectare in size, you can see that that's quite a significant amount of filtration that can go on in the system. They also offer shoreline protection. So they form these habitats or oyster reefs, which can help buffer the nearshore environment from erosion from storm events and also boat wash. And they're also an important fish habitat and very important for fish production. So a lot of fisheries, the plight of a lot of fisheries were linked to oyster reef habitats, in particular in the US, in Chesapeake Bay. There's a large oyster reef restoration program going on there with trying to bring these oysters back. And they found these fish habitats and fisheries production is really linked to that restoration of those oyster habitats. Another thing that was done was to put a value on restoration as well. So can it result in job creation and financial return and also a social enhancement? And so this I'm referring to some values. Recreational fisheries as a whole in Western Australia alone employs around 10,000 people directly. So we're talking about bait shops, you're talking about people who work in government areas which are keeping tabs on fisheries, you've got people that are selling tackle and works. In total, it equates to about $500 million worth of annual revenue to WA every year. So it's a significant value on the fishery. In particular, oysters. This particular oyster has got a superior flavour and quality compared to Pacific oysters or Sydney rock oysters. And so they're very highly valued, and this is part of the reason why we're trying to do that. Consequently, there's been a large buy-in to restoring these oyster reefs down at Albany. So the WA Labor government has pledged about $2 million into helping to restore these oysters in this area. Wreckfish West, which are a peak body for representing recreational fishing in the WA, have pledged already $150,000, which has really seen this work. And also the Nature Conservancy, UWA, and the South Coast NRM, Natural Resource Management Group, down at Albany, have put in a lot of time and effort and dollars into really kickstarting this program. The other key element is to try to build awareness, capacity, and confidence that these degraded areas can actually be repaired. And so in the marine environment, the marine restoration movement, this basically hasn't happened, or not to the degree that it has happened in terrestrial restoration. One of the reasons for this is that we do have shifting baselines. Now, if a lot of you have been to Rottnest, probably in the past, but people going there now see these brochures with these pictures here. And basically, all these boats here, all these dots are here, are all areas where seagrass has been lost. And there's various other areas around the island where these moorings have been removed, or there's been some other historical damage from effluent from toilets, but of course significant damage to seagrasses. So people are actually looking at these environments now and thinking that these now are the norm. Okay, so they're not seeing that it's been damaged. And so this shifting baseline that we're seeing here is basically people going, well, you know, we don't need to worry about restoring these areas because they look great. Shark Bay is another one which has recently undergone a significant change within the region. It's one of the largest continuous seagrass meadows in the world. However, in 2011, it underwent a marine heat wave, which increased the water temperatures between 2 to 4 degrees within the bay. And this went all the way down to the deepest parts within Shark Bay. And so basically what that did, here we've got Amphibolus antarctica, which is one of the main species occurring in Shark Bay. It's actually a temperate species near its northern geographical limit. It had between 50 to 80% loss or degradation of its habitat. So we're looking at about 200,000 hectares of Amphibolus antarctica habitat either lost or degraded in this region. And just to put that on a scale in terms of loss of seagrass around Australia, this one event, which lasted about 1.5 to 2 months, doubled the amount of seagrass loss around Australia in 1 month. So it's actually quite a significant event. Now there are some areas that are recovering, but by far and large, there is still a huge amount of area which is still degraded. There was also some large impacts around south of Shark Bay. We started to find kelp habitat in the cooler waters. There were large losses of kelp habitat when these areas basically turned to bare substrates after that loss. So these losses then had ecosystems with spillover effects. So we did get Shark Bay, we did get a deterioration in the condition of the sea turtles, the green turtles in Shark Bay, and dugongs, and this was because they were basically starving in these areas. There were massive inputs of organic matter to the system, causing a lot of light reduction and seagrass loss as well. So there are carry-on effects from these outcomes. The other point is that we need to go beyond the science. I'm a scientist. I tend to talk about science, and I try to talk a little bit in sort of layman's terms that people understand, but really, we need to start moving beyond that and getting other community people involved, people that have seen these losses, people that have experienced these losses and have sort of anecdotal information to talk with myself and the general public. But these are some major problems in our region. So I'm going to go through a different example, a seagrass example, how we've built awareness of loss and our ability to increase capacity and confidence that we can restore these great seagrass areas. So if we go to a local example of loss of seagrass in Coburn Sound, we see here that back in the 1960s, these areas have been mapped down to between 5 to 10 metres. Down here is a fairly large basin, down to about 18 metres. So seagrass has been mapped in these shallow margins here, the eastern banks, southern areas, southern flats, and down near Rockingham. And then we've also got Garden on the western edge. In 1972, we've got some loss of seagrasses here, looking at over 2,000 hectares of loss in such a short space of time. complete loss of seagrass in the eastern bank and on the southeastern margin. And then by the late 90s, we're getting some losses on this western margin and also down on the western portions here of Cobourg Sound. We've built awareness around the causes of these losses. So we're not just talking about the actual loss, but also awareness around the causes of these losses. So back in the late 60s, we see discharge of cooling waters at James Point, the sewage treatment plant discharging sewage waters that are only treated in the primary filtration stage at the southwestern corner of Wood Point. Blast furnace discharge of black particulates in the late 60s, and also the nitrogen and phosphate fertilizer discharge into Cobourg Sound on the eastern edge. 1969, we begin to see seagrass loss along that eastern shore. So that was where we got those very large losses, up to 2,000 hectares in such a short space of time. Following on from this, we have the construction of the causeway and construction of Genia Garden Island, which caused direct losses of seagrass when they were being constructed, and also ongoing losses from erosion associated with those features in the water. And this is basically what nutrient-rich effluent can do. It basically, it's not toxic so much to the seagrasses, but what it does is it kickstarts the algae into a frenzy of growth. And basically what happens is this algae blankets the seagrasses. It's much better at competing for nutrients and light. It blocks out all the light and all the seagrasses die. After all these events and the fact that we've now built awareness around that there's been loss in Cobourg Sound, and we know the causes of these losses, they then went on to, in the late 90s, to build awareness around the importance, that went into the early 2000s as well, the importance of seagrasses. So let's build the awareness of the importance so the general public and the government can actually see this isn't a habitat that we can just get rid of. So traditional uses, always find this interesting. This is not so much in Australia, a little bit, but in other parts of the world, seagrasses were used for things like insulation, roofing, soil binding agent, which occurs here in our coastal dunes, stuffing and packaging, stock feed. I know in South Australia they were looking at using the seagrasses washed up on the beaches as stock feed, looking at its nutritional quality, and then fiber products, food sources, some seeds of seagrasses you can eat, like Zostra mara, which is eelgrass. You can eat those seeds, or people eat those seeds, and it can also be used as a medicine. Seagrasses are also food and foraging habitat for a lot of charismatic fauna, megafauna. Dugongs and sea turtles, green turtles in particular, live almost exclusively off seagrasses. So when there's loss of their habitat, these habitats, we get a loss of either the health condition of these animals, or we get a loss of those animals completely from the system. A good example is Gladstone over in Queensland, where they had large losses of seagrasses, and basically they were finding dugongs washed up on the shore, and if you could believe, their rib cages were showing because they were that malnourished. You also get these cute little animals here, seahorses, and these are quite abundant in the Swan River. A little bit of night diving, and there are hundreds of these just out of Freshwater Bay and off the beach. Seagrasses are very important as a nursery habitat. So we have a lot of our fish species here which actually need the seagrass habitat to either attach their eggs, or their larvae actually use it as a refuge. Interestingly, a lot of our commercial fisheries, which were heavily reliant on seagrasses as a nursery habitat, have basically been wiped out in Cobourg Sound, as an example. So it's Blue Mountain crab fishery. Crabs stocks have collapsed in the southern portions of Cobourg Sound. We have a snapper, also a scallop fishery, which are also reliant on seagrass meadows for habitat and refuge. Because of those large losses of seagrasses, we've since lost these commercial fisheries, and our recreational fisheries are also suffering. Seagrasses are also important shelter habitat. So this is a decorator crab here with a piece of seagrass stuck on its head as a bit of a headdress. So we saw that walking around. It actually nipped that piece of seagrass off one of our transplants after we transplanted. Shelter. Seagrasses are very important for stabilising the seafloor, especially in locations. This is an example in South Australia, where we've had large losses of seagrass, over 5,000 hectares, and basically this large erosional front of sand has come along and completely covered this rock wall here 1 year later. Seagrasses are also very important as a blue carbon, as a carbon storage area. So if any of you have heard of the term blue carbon, it's in relation to a lot of our coastal vegetation. In particular, salt marshes, mangroves, and seagrasses are incredibly good at storing carbon. That's mostly because these sediments in these environments have very low oxygen availability, so the decomposition process of carbon is very slow. Interestingly, seagrasses cover less than 1% of the globe along the continental margins, but yet contribute about roughly 10% of the estimated burial of carbon across the globe. And just to give you an indication of this in a dollar value, back in 2012, Jim Forgreen from Florida Bay, a few others, did some studies looking at how much carbon was in seagrass within Shark Bay. And they used at that time, the $23 per tonne carbon price. It equated to $8 billion worth of carbon is actually buried under seagrasses within Shark Bay. So I'm run way out of time. Miles of time. So we have built capacity within seagrass restoration. I'll try and move things very quickly. And we've actually built somewhat confidence in restoring seagrasses in Western Australia. Back in the mid-2000s, we found that we could actually put out adult plants of seagrasses and get plants establishing. However, it was very small scale, and basically the costs of doing this were extremely expensive. Okay, so we're looking at costs to replant 1 hectare of seagrass. We're looking at costs between $33,000 to $3.3 million per hectare. That's depending on the technique you use. In general, manual planting of adult transplants or shoots is going to cost about $250,000 using commercial divers. So it's basically unfeasible to do this, and a lot of industry bodies don't want to pay this type of money to do this. So we consulted with Kings Park and a few others to try to look at seeds as a way of restoring seagrasses. So we developed some techniques with the help of a team from Kings Park to actually handle and deliver seeds to sites. And so this process is basically, in this instance, we're looking at Posidonia australis here. We're able to collect large quantities of these seeds, get the seeds out of the fruit, and take those seeds back out into the field. So just to give you an idea of the number of fruit that are actually available for restoration, on top here, the inflorescence flowers here have got lots of fruit. So in this particular area, we've got 80 inflorescence per square metre. We're looking at hundreds, up to thousands of fruit per square metre that we can actually collect from these environments. One of the main approaches that we use to collect these seeds is through diving. The seeds are fruit float. They float up into these purpose-built nets here. And as Guy is demonstrating, this fruit float up and then you're trapped in the net. In this process, we can actually collect tens of thousands of seeds within an hour per dive. And so it's a relatively quick process. We've been able to take those seeds and over a 36-hour period from collection to get them back out to the field. And we're using these broadcast seeding techniques, which are typical of terrestrial vegetation. So here we have Leo moving along and basically spreading these seeds out in an area of Coburn Sound. And then finally, the end product is that broadcast seeding actually works. So here is Gary Kendrick. This is just out of Coogee Marina, where we've done some broadcast seeding, and Gary's basically going along and getting some estimation of how many of these seedlings have survived. These seedlings have been here for over a year now, and we've found that we're getting about 10% survivorship of the seeds that we're putting out there, which are pretty good numbers. It ranges between 2 and up to 10%, but in this particular location, we had some really good results. So I might just leave there because we are running way out of time. But basically, the point here is that we are able to build confidence in what we're doing now. In the past, we haven't because of the huge costs associated with doing restoration, seagrass restoration. This process is providing a lot of promise to reducing those costs. And we can also do this at quite large scales as well. Thank you.